Do I have a juicy one for you today? So today I'm taking you guys through Garo's ascension from a martial arts prodigy to possibly being able to destroy an entire planet with a single attack. I'm literally going to be going through Garo's entire journey from the moment he gets to the Monster Association, which is where the anime leaves off, all the way up to where we are now in the manga. If you watch until the end, you'll get a great idea of just how insane of a glow up Garo has had over the last few years. So get comfortable and let's get right into it. Garo wakes up to find himself inside the headquarters of the Monster Association. After Narinki's private army is captured by G5 and turned into Super S slaves, Garo is requested by Orochi to bring back the head of any hero to prove that he is a monster within one day. Girogiro commands Bug God and Royal Ripper to monitor Garo as the Hero Hunter completes this endeavor. A new group, named the Monster Worship Party, agrees with the recent monster outbreak and attempts to capture a citizen for disagreeing with their ideology, but have the misfortune of bumping into Garo, who knocks them out with a single flick before heading to a restaurant nearby and eating everything on the menu. Saitama is having lunch at the same restaurant, but is not able to pay because he lost his wallet. While Saitama and Fubuki are speaking, Garo dine and dashes, to which Saitama uses the opportunity to chase after him and leave the bill to Fubuki. Later, Garo scares some boys who were bullying Terrio. Terrio thanks Garo for his heroism, which disgusts Garo. Soon enough, Saitama catches up to Garo and lets Garo off with a warning. This severely angers him, thinking that heroes are starting to take pity on him. He resolves to carrying out his task by bringing back Saitama's head, but Saitama accidentally punches Garo, knocking him out. Sometime later, Garo wakes up and asks Terrio who the hero was. Immediately after though, Bug God and Royal Ripper confront Garo for not seeming like a monster. Royal Ripper approaches Terrio, to which Garo tells him to back off. Garo assumes a stance in front of Terrio as Bug God and Royal Ripper approach the pair. Royal Ripper reveals that Girogiro has sent him and Bug God to follow and monitor Garo. After observing his behavior, they had now have doubts about Garo's intent, questioning whether if he is a true monster or not. Garo then proceeds to provoke Royal Ripper to little use as the latter then demands the former to kill Terrio. Garo then inquires about the reasoning behind the request, to which Bug God replies that one must leave behind what makes them human in order to qualify as a monster. Royal Ripper reaffirms the statement and continues, adding that Garo might not be the best candidate after being defeated by Saitama. Garo then proceeds to tell Terrio to go home, but he's unable to do so out of fear. Due to this, Terrio is berated by Garo, who then forces the hero catalog out of his hand, saying that the boy needs to get stronger during times like these. While doing so, Royal Ripper attacks Terrio. The attack is quickly stopped by Garo, who hoists Royal Ripper up in the air by his blades and swiftly delivers a kick to his abdomen. Royal Ripper then flies into the air as a result, but is quick to get back on his feet. The move severely disfigures his arms, but Royal Ripper restores his limbs back to their original state by twisting them back. Then Garo yells at Terrio, telling him to run. The boy complies and is seen dashing away. As he is doing so, Royal Ripper announces Garo to be an enemy, and Garo then assumes a stance as the two monsters charge at him. At the Monster Association's headquarters, Girogiro is seen meditating on a beanbag while Phoenix Man enters the room. Phoenix Man then asks Girogiro for an explanation for sending two aggressive monsters to observe Garo, to which Girogiro replies that the two might be able to mentor Garo on killing heroes. Phoenix Man quickly sees through this evasion, stating that the two are too unruly to follow orders and will murder Garo if given the chance. As a counterargument, Girogiro states that Garo needs to be physically and mentally pushed to the limit to develop. Phoenix Man curiously asks Girogiro what its plan is to do with Garo. Girogiro goes on to say that Garo could become the next Orochi if given this treatment. Girogiro adds that it ordered Bug God to stop Royal Ripper from killing Garo, and that if Garo were to perish, Girogiro would simply find another specimen. We then go back to Garo. As the two monsters charge him, Garo delivers a punch towards Bug God's torso. Unfortunately, this injures his own hand. Royal Ripper then performs a chain of frenzied slashes aimed at Garo, but they are all dodged or reflected. As Garo is busy with Royal Ripper's chain of attacks, Bug God approaches him from behind, but is bombarded with a flurry of deflected slashes that came from Royal Ripper. The monster is undeterred by this, as he quickly pounds Garo into the ground and then flings him into electrical cables, which briefly electrocutes Garo. Garo immediately rebounds himself toward the two monsters as they leap towards him. The three enter a stalemate, with Garo now confident in his abilities to defeat his opponents, while the pair of monsters declaring that they haven't gone all out yet. Garo is not discouraged by this, even going on to say that he has seen everything they have to offer and will not be hit by them again. It is then shown that Terrio was captured by Sludge Jellyfish. Garo gets distracted by this, so Royal Ripper brutally slashes him in the back and subsequently is stabbed in the torso by Bug God before ultimately being assailed with a series of slashes, leaving him in a pool of blood. Bug God quickly puts a stop to the assault, explaining that Garo should be left alive. Royal Ripper ceases his attacking but declares that it might be too late for Garo. He then invites Terrio back to the Monster Association with an eerie grin, saying that they will be great friends. In the Monster Association, Royal Ripper and Bug God try to explain Garo's quote-unquote death to Girogiro by putting the blame on Garo and then Girogiro. Girogiro sees through their lies, but spares them from punishment and tells them to take things seriously as the Hero Association could attack in a few hours. Meanwhile, Garo awakens in the spot where he was abandoned and begins to move off. Back underground, Garo breaks into the facility just in time to save Terrio from Royal Ripper. Despite being stabbed in the gut by the monster, Garo punched Royal Ripper's head clean off with one blow, killing him in the process, before using the Whirlwind Iron Cutting Fist to shred the monster to pieces. He and Terrio then make their escape, only to encounter two monsters who were quickly defeated by Garo. The Hero Hunter devours one of the limbs of the monsters to replenish himself before proceeding with Terrio. As they make their escape, Terrio tells him that there's another child that is in need of rescuing, but Garo says that that's none of his concern and that he didn't come to save Terrio either. However, before the two continue, they are confronted by Overgrown Rover. They're interrupted by three demon level monsters, but Garo makes quick work of them. Rover then shoots a powerful beam towards Garo, which vaporizes the other three monsters. Garo attempts to run away, but is hit with a beam that is too close for him to dodge and it sends him flying through multiple floors of the Monster Association. Heavily damaged, Garo tries to land a hit on Rover, but it has no effect on him. Rover unleashes one final blast on Garo that sends him through even more floors of the hideout, leaving him defeated and restrained by Girogiro. Garo gets restrained by Girogiro's psychic powers. Girogiro comments on Garo's incomplete monster transformation, bringing out his great potential but still lacking greatly. Girogiro wants to elevate Garo into an even greater monster, not through psychic powers like Garo questions, but through a specialized monsterification process. Girogiro explains that in order to accelerate the growth process, the human must be repeatedly experiencing death in order to overwhelm the body and spirit. This is a delicate balance as the human can easily succumb to death during the process and even successful candidates will stagnate due to low intelligence. The key ingredient needed is for the human to experience their own personal hell. Garo says that it sounds like Girogiro performed this process numerous times, to which Girogiro confirms on both humans and monsters. While it is easy to turn humans into monsters, the process simply improves existing abilities the human has and little to none prospect of further growth. Some experiments Girogiro performed to break this growth limit include cannibalism, blood and cell transfusion, breeding, torturing, inciting their anger and hatred, and more. Garo stares on grimly. From Girogiro's experiments, the repeated experiences of death allows the person to explosively grow in strength and abilities. Girogiro mentions that Garo has qualities greater than Orochi, and through his battle with Royal Ripper and Bug God, Garo has broken through another wall of limits. Girogiro offers Garo to join forces. Under Girogiro's guidance, they will crush the heroes and Garo will attain the power to become the strongest monster. Garo refuses, but Girogiro says that he never had a choice. Girogiro reasserts Garo's powerlessness again by reminding him of his bindings and her psychic powers dwarfing the witch sisters, Tatsumaki and Fubuki. Nevertheless, Garo begins to break free as he starts to take a step. This time Girogiro disciplines Garo with force and throws rocks at him. In doing so, a weakness is revealed in that Girogiro can only perform one action at a time and Garo is freed from his binding. Garo mocks Girogiro and that by killing the brain behind the Monster Association, it will naturally collapse in itself. Orochi intervenes, grabbing Garo and pulling him down to eye level with Orochi. The stage reconstructs with Girogiro's prodding and Garo begins to do battle. Orochi fires his horns at him, piercing Garo and leaving a visible round hole in his abdomen. Girogiro comments on Orochi's horn manipulation as his first discovery as a monster. Garo defends himself with Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist and stays on the move, killing some monsters as he does so. Garo leaps to attack Orochi head on, but mouths within mouths open up in Orochi's jaw and almost bite down on him. Orochi transforms into a serpent-like being, and the reptile heads on his body fire a superheated flame at Garo, incinerating the entire stage. A fist forms from Snake's appendages and smacks down on Garo, sending him into the wall. Girogiro calls for Garo to give up, but he refuses, bragging about his status as a genius combatant. He acknowledges Orochi's strength, but claims that he is missing the primal terror that makes him a true monster. Garo utilizes Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist and shifts into a fighting stance. Much to his surprise, Orochi copies his stance, and Girogiro informs him that Orochi too is a genius in the same way that Garo is, having managed to adapt his style as they fought. The fight renews, and this time the dragon appendages all utilize Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist. Garo is then easily defeated. Girogiro comments on Garo's lack of bloodlust commonly found in monsters despite his intense wish to become one. As such, Girogiro plans to thoroughly brainwash him into an ace of the Monster Association. Super Alloy Darkshine encounters Bug God and tells him that along with Tatsumaki and King, he is one of the three heroes you must never anger. Bug God transforms into a new form, growing 4 extra arms and wings, but Super Alloy Darkshine destroys the monster in one hit. Puri Puri Prisoner swims through the underground walls of the Monster Association base, searching for Neon. He ends up in a small chamber filled with torture equipment and notices Garo chained to the wall, seemingly unconscious. Not recognizing Garo as the infamous hero hunter, Puri Puri Prisoner thinks he's simply another human hostage and moves to release him, introducing himself as an S-class hero. However, just as Puri Puri Prisoner is recognizing Garo's face from the wanted posters, Garo awakens and breaks the chains before swiftly pummeling the hero. Darkshine finds Puri Puri Prisoner defeated on the ground. Puri Puri Prisoner warns Darkshine about Garo, who appears at the end of the corridor. Darkshine unleashes a devastating tackle that pierces through Garo's guard with ease and sends him through multiple layers of the Monster Association headquarters. Garo's ribs are shattered by the blow, but he soon recovers. He uses Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist and Whirlwind Iron Cutting Fist to start a barrage of attacks that make the indestructible hero consider the possibility of defeat. Darkshine then uses his full power to punch Garo with Super Alloy Bazooka, but Garo meets his fist with a blow of his own. The narrator comments that Garo's limiter is starting to break. Garo continues his beatdown on Super Alloy Darkshine. He slips past a punch from Darkshine and delivers a strike that forces the hero to cough up blood. As Garo continues his assault, Darkshine realizes he was never looking for a real fight. Rather, he sought a fight that could give him a satisfying victory. He lashes out in despair and knocks Garo back, but the injuries are covered with dark spirals and Garo recovers immediately. Garo kicks him in the stomach and pins him to the ground with a follow-up kick. He moves to strike at Darkshine's ears, but pulls back when the hero yelps in fear. Garo then compares this to bullying at this point, a pathetic evil compared to what he aims for. Suddenly, Garo's joints start to crack and the dark marks on his body crawl towards his face. A psychic barrier created by Tatsumaki surrounds Darkshine and pulls him up as the ceiling collapses, leaving Garo behind. Darkshine rising higher tells Garo to run. As he loses sight of Garo, he hangs his head in shame. Having seen Super Alloy Darkshine sitting on the ground with a sad expression on his face, the other heroes come closer to him. Puri Puri Prisoner and Zombie Man are shocked to know that he lost to Garo. Darkshine then retells his experience about Garo to the other heroes, admitting that he was completely defeated by the hero hunter, also noting that the latter will show up again with no one else being able to stop him. Meanwhile, Garo, who is deep underground and buried by debris, begins to rise up. He wonders why the more he is beaten, the more he feels like he gets stronger, and realizes that he is one step closer to becoming the monster that he envisions to be, calling himself Despair Incarnate, desiring to make the world become the way that he wants it to be. He then seems to begin transforming into a monstrous state. Suddenly, Garo, with a monstrous appearance, emerges from underground and confronts both Fubuki and Bomb. The elder martial artist then loudly calls Bang, informing his brother and the others of Garo's presence. As Bang is busy holding off Black S's clones, Atomic Samurai tells him to go and leave the rest to him, much to Bang's gratitude. Bomb prepares to fight Garo as he tells Fubuki to stay back. Garo starts engaging in combat with Bomb, and the two of them are capable of holding their own relatively well against each other. Fubuki watches the battle and tries to assist the old man against the hero hunter. However, they are fighting so fast that her eyes can't follow their movements. As Fubuki appears to lose her focus, Garo tries to attack her, but Bomb manages to block his strike, then purposefully lands a blow on Garo that sends him flying away in an attempt to keep Fubuki away from the fighting. Garo and Bomb continue fighting. Bomb contemplates Garo's extremely rapid growth, noting that the Hero Hunter's new customized style, which has fused every technique together, might be a result of monsterification. Even at a disadvantage, Bomb resolves not to go down until Bang arrives, and he prepares a powerful cutting move which he conceals behind his back. Striking the ground to disorient Garo, Bomb seizes the opportunity to launch his attack, but is shocked to find that Garo perfectly matched and canceled his blow. With a single hit, Garo knocks Bomb to the ground. Bang arrives just in time, and comments on Garo's miserable state before deciding to go all out against his former disciple. They begin engaging in combat, and the two of them are capable of fighting evenly against each other. Garo manages to make his former master bleed after a brief clash, causing Bang to remark that he is now more worth teaching than before. Garo and Bang continue their fight, with Garo then taking the stance of Exploding Heart Release Fist, a fighting style that Bang primarily used before developing Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist. Both Bang and Bomb are surprised, and Bomb asks his brother how Garo attained this fighting style when it was sealed long ago. Bang reveals that Garo broke into the safe that contained the scrolls of secret techniques in his dojo as he was escaping. Bang tells Bomb to watch carefully. He keeps on fighting and attempts to reach Garo by the voice hidden within his fists. He then decides that he will quit being a hero after this incident and expresses his desire to be Garo's master once again. Garo eventually demonstrates his roaring aura of sky-ripping fist to the shock of both Bang and Bomb as he crosses fists with Bang in a rapid clash of blows. The intense shockwaves generated by Garo's technique are so powerful that they turn even debris within the vicinity into powder, which prompts Bomb to remark that it will be over for Bang if he takes any direct hit from the hero hunter, as the shockwaves will course through him and wreck his body. However, Bang is able to effectively avoid that devastating technique from Garo until they attempt to land a final attack on each other. Bang successfully punches Garo in the face, cracking his outer monster shell, while Garo simply grazes Bang's chest, but the shockwave from his blow is still strong enough to produce heavy damage on Bang, which makes him finally fall in defeat after a tough fight. Bomb expresses his concern about his brother's condition. He then notices that Fira Ugly is approaching his brother as the fat monster smiles and is delighted that he finally has found Bang to claim his revenge. Child Emperor and Atomic Samurai wonder why King is not unleashing his ultimate Hellfire Burst Wave motion cannon, while Puri Puri Prisoner and E-Iron observe Platinum S. King finally starts unfolding his arms, prompting the other heroes to think that he's about to release his ultimate attack and cheer him on. Suddenly, Platinum S extends the tentacle on his head and attacks some of the heroes around King in the blink of an eye, incapacitating them. King is frightened, with Platinum S telling him that he is aware that King has desired a one-on-one battle between him from the beginning. Platinum S proceeds to challenge King, telling him to unleash his ultimate attack so that Platinum S can tear his head clean off at that same moment. Fear Ugly is standing in front of Bang, who is lying defeated, and wonders if Garo is the one who has beaten him. Garo, having the skin in his left eye shattered, begins roaring and charging towards Fira Ugly, who is about to finish off Bang, and rips a hole through the monster's body with a kick. As King is closing his eyes and shouting the name of his attack to intimidate the opponents, Garo proceeds to dash in the direction of Platinum S, sending him flying in with a single punch. Evil Natural Water senses Garo's murderous intentions and attacks him with two water jets, only for the Hero Hunter to deflect them and begin slashing the water monster with multiple blows in extreme quick succession. All of Garo's actions have happened in less than even a second, so fast that King was not even aware of his presence. Metal Bat, observing from afar, is excited as he thinks King has beaten the monsters. King falls backwards and is confused about what just happened. Fira Ugly is shocked at seeing the fatal injury he has received and shortly collapses into a pile of mush. Garo stands on his feet and mutters about his former master. He then notices that a black wormhole emerges near him and it releases Saitama, Flashy Flash, and Monaco, who are all seemingly surprised as they have been teleported to the surface by Blast. Flashy Flash notices that Garo is near him, while Saitama rushes towards Genos, expressing his concern about the cyborg's condition. Saitama goes on by asking him if Garo is the one who is responsible for his sorry state, which Genos responds that it was actually a monster executive who did this to him. Having just regained his senses, Garo is confused about his new form, noting that he does not remember ever resurfacing from underground and was dreaming about sparring with Bang in the past. To his surprise, Flashy Flash throws a kick at Garo, with him narrowly dodging it. Garo recognizes him as the 13th ranked S-class hero. Flashy Flash asks him if he is the Monster King, to which the Hero Hunter answers that he has nothing to do with the Hero Association, and reveals that his name is Garo. In an instant, Planet Mess interrupts by simultaneously passing through and pummeling them. He is disappointed by Garo, stating that despite the latter having monsterized so much, he still does not have the courage to join the monsters. Unfazed by the sudden attack, both Flashy Flash and Garo start a free-for-all battle with Platinum S. The three of them begin exchanging blows at incredible speeds. The battle between Garo, Flashy Flash, and Platinum S generates a geometric structure of light covering the sky due to them moving at an unimaginable speed. It is mistakenly believed by most of those who are observing to be the work of Tatsumaki and other Espers, with only a few aware that those are the trails of the battle between them. During the fight, Planet Mess suggests that him and Garo team up to defeat Flashy Flash, pointing out that the hero has been weakened due to losing his sword. As Garo pretends to agree with him, Planet Mess lets his guard down and is punched in the face by the Hero Hunter, much to his anger. Just then, Garo begins to showcase his Monster Calamity God Slayer Fist, a fighting style that is the combination of many martial arts that he has learned through his battles, and overwhelms both Flashy Flash and Planet Mess. Deep underground, where a mysterious shrine is located, a centipede-like creature is seen growing bigger and bigger. In the meantime, a massive aircraft carrier called Gats Oki is operating at sea. They notice on their radar that a mysterious, enormous presence is emerging from the water. As they prepare to withstand the impact of it, a pair of gigantic eyes emerge from the ocean, capsizing the entire aircraft carrier. The battle between Garo, Flashy Flash, and Platinum S continues. Flashy Flash is starting to get overwhelmed, and is shocked at the fact that in a single day, he has encountered four people who have surpassed his supposedly unmatched speed. He desperately tries to best Garo and Platinum S, but fails, with him eventually being defeated by the latter. The remaining two fighters resume their accelerated battle, exchanging a multitude of blows in the sky within only 1.3 milliseconds, before Garo manages to send Platinum S into the ground. As Platinum S quickly gets up and calls out Garo's name, he's finally defeated by the Hero Hunter, who instantly passes through him while delivering a blow that causes him to explode into bits. Immediately after, a big earthquake occurs and the source of it is revealed to be Sage Centipede, who emerges from the deep hole where Tatsumaki had attacked Orochi before. After showing up, Sage Centipede loudly claims that it has been sent to destroy the abominable fist that has opposed God and declares itself the incarnation of the Father Earth. As Sage Centipede directs his eyes towards the sea, evil natural water, now known as evil ocean water, begins rising. Sage Centipede refers to evil ocean water as the incarnation of Mother Ocean, stating that along with the latter, it will bring total destruction. In an instant, Garo jumps up towards Sage Centipede and pummels it in the head. Garo's combo attacks have proven quite effective against Sage Centipede, who has taken damage and is stunned by the Hero Hunter's assault. Garo notices that there is a helicopter from afar and sees that Terrio is inside of it. He is surprised that the boy managed to escape the Monster Association headquarters and then taunts Sage Centipede, trying to attract his attention. However, Sage Centipede realizes that the helicopter behind it concerns Garo, and it tells him not to move, otherwise evil ocean water will shoot down the helicopter with its great ocean cannon. While Garo is shocked after hearing this, Sage Centipede attacks him with its Centipede Grand March, surrounding and striking him repeatedly, with evil ocean water aiding the centipede by shooting a devastating water cannon at the Hero Hunter. From afar, King observes the great destruction caused by evil ocean water's water cannon while carrying an injured Tatsumaki. Garo is badly hurt and launched a great distance while Sage Centipede laughs at him. At this moment, Sage Centipede notices that something is dashing towards the sea at lightning speed, leaving powerful shockwaves in its wake. This is revealed to be Saitama, who proceeds to jump towards evil ocean water and strikes it with a serious punch. Upon contact, the punch dissipates evil ocean water and splits the entire ocean, shocking Sage Centipede, who does not understand what just happened. Sage Centipede then pursues the helicopter, which holds Terrio and Waganma inside. Garo, already recovering from the damage that he just took, chases the monster. Suddenly, Metal Bat jumps onto Sage Centipede and strikes it many times in the face. However, Sage Centipede shrugs off his attacks and simply tosses him away. While on his way to reach the monster, Garo runs into Metal Bat, and the two of them are surprised to see each other again. believing him to be getting in his way once more. Metalbat attacks the Hero Hunter, but he swiftly evades the hero's swings and keeps moving forward, ignoring him. Garl jumps onto Sage Centipede's back, with Metalbat catching up to him. While they almost reach the monster's head, a reporter helicopter pops up right above the centipede, much to the monster's annoyance. Sage Centipede then strikes the reporter helicopter with one of its antennas. However, Metalbat appears in front of the helicopter and blocks a strike, while Garl gets onto the helicopter and scares off the people inside, causing it to fly away from the scene. Immediately after, Garl charges towards Sage Centipede and lands a barrage of attacks. Despite taking these blows head-on, Sage Centipede is only momentarily knocked back and quickly recovers. Both Garl and Metalbat stand side by side and assume their stances. Metalbat questions what is wrong with Garl, given that he has not only attacked Sage Centipede but also helped the reporter helicopter escape, commenting that he is now even more sensible than when he was a human. Garl responds by saying that he just wants to show the world how terrifying he is. He informs the hero of the monster's target being the rescue helicopter behind them, stating that the two have to buy some time for it to get away. Garl suggests Metalbat act as a decoy, much to the hero's anger. After an argument, they finally team up against Sage Centipede. Garl and Metalbat unleash their respective techniques, Roaring Aura Sky Ripping Fist and Savage Tornado on Sage Centipede. However, their attacks cannot bring down the monster due to its extreme durability as well as its powerful regeneration ability. While recognizing Garl's strength, Sage Centipede thinks of the Metalbat as a non-threat and considers taking him hostage. Garl criticizes Metalbat for being unable to deal any damage to the centipede-like monster, and upon hearing their argument, Sage Centipede figures out that it would not work. Sage Centipede continues to pursue the helicopter, which Terrio and the wounded heroes are inside, in an attempt to take the plane hostage. Sage Centipede eventually catches the helicopter with its antennas, shattering the rotor and taking the people inside hostage. At this moment, Garl and Metalbat both stop dead in their tracks. Immediately after this, Sage Centipede attacks the two with its Centipede Grand March, causing the entire terrain to change and seemingly taking them down. Due to the damage sustained, Garl is on his knees and subsequently grabbed by one of the monster's arms. Just as he's about to be killed by Sage Centipede, One-Shotter, now able to aim accurately thanks to having been supported by Gearspur, shoots the monster multiple times in the eyes, momentarily distracting it and allowing Garl to escape. Garl proceeds to pummel Sage Centipede, with Terrio and the other heroes mistaking him for a hero and cheering him on. As Garl attempts to free the helicopter from the monster's antennas and is about to attack, Metalbat, with his serious injuries, appears and chops off Sage Centipede's antenna, much to his surprise. Having received massive injuries, Metalbat, through his fighting spirit, was pumped up, and his strength has increased higher than before. He then informs Garl, who is holding the helicopter, of a huge net 500 meters away, which allows the Hero Hunter to throw the helicopter to safety, much to Sage Centipede's displeasure. The two of them then stand side by side, ready to give the monster all they have. Sage Centipede refers to their team-up as pathetic shortly before charging at them with his 6,666-leg Grand Drill. In response, Garl and Metalbat, working in tandem, utilize their strong techniques respectively, Cross Fang Dragon Slayer Fist and Savage Hurricane, accidentally creating a combo attack against the giant monster, successfully countering its rush and even cracking its durable shell, much to its shock. Metalbat and Garl continue their assault, with the former now strong enough to damage Sage Centipede's exoskeleton with every single swing due to his resonating with Garl, although he is quickly knocked back by the monster. Garl, having his strength also increased greatly due to him resonating with Metalbat, is now able to blast through Sage Centipede's body and steal its regeneration core, ceasing the monster's ability to regenerate. While Sage Centipede is shocked at the fact that it can no longer regenerate from damage, Garl explains that he noticed a certain spot on the monster that was releasing energy and therefore figured out that it was his core. Sage Centipede attempts to take back his core, but the Hero Hunter throws the regeneration core into the sky at high speeds. He and Sage Centipede then try to catch up to the core. Metalbat, unable to continue fighting, lies on the ground and mutters that Garl has defeated Sage Centipede, before seemingly becoming unconscious as a result of his injuries. Sage Centipede is finally able to reach his core by extending his large antennas, having revealed its immense length as it extends all the way up from the ground into space. However, Garl, having run across its back, leaps up at the regeneration core and completely destroys it. While heading towards Sage Centipede with a karate chop, Garl recalls how he first joined Bang's dojo and failed to break 50 tiles in a single chop, leaving only one left, a testament to his capabilities as a newcomer. The giant centipede finally meets its end as the hero hunter chops it in half vertically all the way down to the surface, declaring that his fist has now been perfected. After defeating said centipede, Garo takes a look at his surroundings and is unable to see any S-class heroes. He concludes that there is no more enemies around and thinks of becoming absolute evil while reassuring himself that there should have been nothing left for him to fear. However, he suddenly has a feeling that he is missing something that bothers him, although he cannot remember it. Immediately after that, Saitama appears before Garo and asks the hero hunter what he is supposed to be. While wondering about Saitama's identity, Garo guesses that he is a lower rank hero sent out for rescue operations. He responds to Saitama, telling him his name and his goals of becoming absolute evil, as well as spreading fear across the world. Despite this explanation, Saitama is still confused about whether Garo is actually evil, citing that the latter has rescued a helicopter from Sage Centipede and has also defeated the centipede monster. Attempting to clear Saitama's doubts, Garo states that he just wanted the others to spread his influence and to know that he is stronger than any other hero or monster, reasoning that absolute evil also means absolute strength. Garo then tells Saitama to leave and to think about quitting his job as a hero, as he claims that he will annihilate the Hero Association. As Saitama is about to leave, he states that Garo does not look like a monster to him, which surprises Garo. Saitama goes on by telling Garo that he went to complain about the noise below his house, and for some reason, his house then got destroyed, which makes him become furious and feel like he wants to blow away the entire earth. While walking away, Saitama tells Garo not to overdo it, whether he is playing hero or monster. After hesitating for a moment and feeling that he has seen him before, Garo calls out to him, stating that underestimating absolute evil is a huge mistake, shortly before trying to attack the hero. However, Saitama simply sends him flying backwards with a single punch. At this moment, Garo finally remembers Saitama, recognizing him as a mysterious bald man that he's run into several times. As he is losing consciousness, Garo laments about how he had forgotten the target that should have taken priority over all else. The fight between Garo and Saitama then begins to get more serious. Despite Garo viciously attacking him, Saitama is able to comfortably fend off his assault. He then throws a punch at Garo, but the hero hunter manages to dodge his punch before axe kicking him into the ground, causing great destruction to a landmass on impact. As Saitama quickly stands up, Garo charges at him with a hand chop, directly striking his head. However, Saitama's head making contact with Garo's arm completely shatters it. Despite the damage, Garo instantly regenerates his arm and proceeds to attack Saitama, who on the other hand just wants to talk to him. Out of frustration, Saitama punches Garo, sending him flying far into the distance towards Terrio and the other hero's whereabouts. Just as Terrio comes up to him, Garo's body begins to mutate, something that frightens the boy. Seeing Garo as a monster, Lightning Max and Snack jump in front of Terrio to defend him. Wounded people and the other heroes all soon get into two boats and leave with Terrio. While the boat carrying him away starts heading towards the sea, Terrio gets away from it and swims back to the land in order to meet with Garo. Despite encountering Garo in his mutated form, Terrio is not afraid of him and instead calls him a hero. Annoyed by Terrio, Garo again tries to explain to him that he is not a hero but is denied by the boy, who tells him that he was saved by Garo four times. Terrio goes on by stating that Garo is the greatest hero in his eyes and tells him to stop pretending to be a monster. As Garo seems to be upset, Saitama shows up. Like Terrio, he also states that Garo is pretending to be a monster and then talks about his cosplay. While Saitama slowly walks to them, Garo tells Terrio to watch closely as he will show him how powerless heroes really are. Terrio attempts to stop him from fighting Saitama, stating that he will be acknowledged as a real monster should he hurt any of the heroes. When he is right in front of Garo, Saitama taunts him to attack, causing Garo to punch him hard in the head, to Terrio's shock. Unfazed by the punch, Saitama reassures Terrio that everything will be fine. Garo immediately attempts another attack on Saitama, but is thrown away by the hero with a slap. Terrio calls out to Garo and is asked by Saitama if he wants him to stop Garo. Terrio responds with a nod, to which Saitama then heads towards the hero hunter. Garo laments on his inability to keep up with Saitama despite having continuously become stronger through monsterification. While asking Garo about his goals, Saitama points out the contradiction between his words and his actions, stating that despite his explanation, he did help heroes against the centipede-like monster. Garo reasons that he was simply using Metal Bat to further his goals. Saitama then interprets Garo's absolute evil as world peace, which upsets him. Suddenly, Garo starts attacking Saitama again, with his blows landing effectively while also avoiding Saitama's blows. Annoyed, Saitama asks Garo whether he is using martial arts to avoid his punches, which Garo confirms. While their fight proceeds, Garo notes that Saitama has amazing speed and reflexes that compensate for his lack of skill and technique, but still has a lot of openings for him to take advantage of. Claiming to be able to read every single one of Saitama's moves, Garo declares that the hero will lose due to his lack of technique and being a complete amateur, before sending him crashing into several buildings with his powerful combo attacks. Believing that he has won, Garo states that Saitama may have incredibly tough skin and bones, but he cannot train his internal organs, which Garo believes to have been damaged by his attack. It is then shown that Garo, in destroying the buildings, accidentally saved five Hero Association staff members who have been inside an underground shelter in the rubble. As all of them show their gratitude to him before leaving, Saitama ironically comments how absolute evil is good at saving people. Enraged, Garo attacks Saitama again and suddenly begins to evolve, taking on a demonic form with a pair of wings and long horns. As he continues to try and overcome Saitama, Garo once again accidentally does a heroic deed by smashing him into a big volcano, which its lava is about to cover a city, and shatters it, causing the lava to flow on the other side of the mountain, subsequently saving the whole city. Despite Garo's efforts, Saitama is unharmed and punches him back. After seeing that the mountain behind Saitama has been shattered while the hero himself completely is unscathed, Garo is impressed that Saitama is tougher than a mountain. Noticing that Garo has just saved the city without being aware of it, Saitama comments on how the hero hunter reminds him of King and that Garo himself has a great hero instinct. Garo continues to struggle against Saitama, using a flurry of rapid punches to launch him into the sky, only for Saitama to ask him where he learned it from. As he wonders if he can ever become absolute evil, he sees his opponent casually swatting his attacks one-handedly, enraging him. Using his rear arms to propel himself, Garo lunges at Saitama using extreme Fa Jin, driving the hero and himself deep into the mountain below. The force of the attack sends waves of energy rippling through the Earth's mantle and causing a portion of the land to rise up from the other side. A downed passenger plane is unexpectedly rescued when the planet's crust rises upwards, save for an unlucky lifeboat. Now somewhat annoyed, Saitama uses consecutive normal punches and propels Garo out of the mountain they were just trapped in, destroying it in the process. Confused that none of his strategies are working against Saitama, the hero hunter ponders on Sage Centipede's sole intentions, believing that the abominable fist that opposed God isn't about himself but is actually about Saitama. The hero lands another titanic punch, sending Garo hurtling through several mountains and landing a great distance out into the drained sea. Exhausted, he sees Saitama land down and approach him. Denouncing him as the embodiment of unfairness, he makes a final attempt to strike the hero, only to be punched so hard that his human body breaks out of the monstrous shell that he was in. At that moment, a series of clouds appear in the sky, and a voice calls out to him, "I can hear you." Suddenly, an enormous foot steps down onto the earth, shrouded in lightning strikes. As the heroes regard the otherworldly scene in horror, another foot lands down onto the surface, and the enigmatic figure begins to walk. The figure stands in front of Garo's unconscious body, and it begins to rise up as the figure calls out to Garo. Confused by who's calling him, Garo hears the figure talking about his deepest wishes and how it's all falling apart at the hands of one hero. Aggravated by these words, Garo threatens the voice, but it continues, claiming that there is only one fist that can turn against the fist that has turned against God. Garo demands the figure to show his face, but it only laughs at his threats, reminding him that he is only trying to help. As Garo turns his head and opens his eyes, he sees Bang, shrouded in darkness, holding out his hand. The figure claims that there is no master willing to watch as their student gets beaten up. As Garo seemingly holds out his hand, reaching out to Bang, the enormous face of God peers through the clouds and gives Garo a new power. Saitama suddenly sees something landing down from the sky. He looks at Garo and wonders about his changed costume, only to scratch his eyes and squint at him, unable to believe at what he's seeing. Now appearing as a void of stars and galaxies, Garo mutters the figure's words about what opposes the fist that is turned against God, calling that entity the Fist of God. His new mode is then revealed, Awakened Garo, Cosmic Fear Mode. It is then revealed that Garo has gained unimaginable power, being able to use the knowledge of energy and behaviors in the universe to create his own attacks, copying them. Using All Life Eradication Fist, Nuclear Fission, Garo attacks Saitama head-on, catching the hero off guard. The blow becomes a towering mushroom of clouds, with the decontamination system of the Gats Oki activated, causing its personnel to realize that the attack carries the power of a nuclear weapon. In the distance, Saiko sees that the energy spheres of this attack look akin to homeless emperors, though she sees that they are much more powerful, referring to them as divine power. As the heroes look up to see the rising mushroom cloud, they see humanoid shapes rapidly shifting from inside. Genos can only wonder if Saitama has something to do with it. Saitama remains unharmed by the explosion, but becomes irritated that his clothes were now tattered. Garo laughs at his worry for his clothing and declares that he can see through his moves. The hero grows frustrated at Garo's words and claims that he will simply get pummeled again. In response, Garo states that in martial arts, one can use the power of nature by borrowing the movements of living things, calling these techniques modes because they sound cooler. Garo then suddenly activates a new mode, Saitama, and attacks the hero with consecutive normal punches, greatly surprising him. Saitama responds with the same attack, and the flurry of strikes collide with each other, causing a giant explosion. Garo and Saitama make contact with one another, causing their bodies to get pushed deep into the ocean, though both figures quickly resurface and resume their battle. Wondering if this is the first time that Saitama has met someone that has matched him blow for blow, he states that he will soon hone his technique faster than he can adapt and claims that the hero won't catch up. Saitama becomes dismayed for telling Terrio that he won't get scratched. Garo can only find his concern for that brat funny in the middle of the battle, before remembering that he wanted to show Terrio how powerless heroes truly are. Garo then suddenly uses All Life Eradication Fist, Gamma Ray Burst, forming two beams of energy in a central burst lighting the sky. The heroes desperately hold themselves down as the energy shockwaves hits them. We then see a Mai Mask approach Flashy Flash, with Monaco behind the S-Class hero. Fueled by hatred of monsters, a Mai Mask demands to know why he is harboring one. Flashy Flash responds by claiming that he is an exotic animal and is useful to him. Garo then interrupts their conversation and smashes down in front of the heroes. Tank Top Master wonders if this really is the hero hunter that he fought before. Zombie Man believes that the situation will go down terribly, and Flashy Flash surmises that running away will be useless to them. As everyone looks at him in terror, Garo believes that he is now the symbol of fear that he has longed to be. He's finally become absolute evil, and looks up to the sky, thanking him. Crawling from the debris, Bang sees his former student and approaches him, shocked by his appearance. The former master asks Garo if he is still in his right senses. Garo responds by stating that he always was. At this moment, Garo recalled when he gained his power, during his encounter with God, who he knew was impersonating his former master in order to make him a puppet. We then come to find out that Garo initially rejected God's power by slapping his hand away. However, by simply touching his hand, this allowed God to influence him anyways. As Garo is then racked with pain, he demands to know what God has done to him. The figure responds by claiming that he will make Garo his new avatar before quickly disappearing. Back to the present, Garo tells Bang that he still retains his lessons regarding Water Stream Rock Smashing Fist and says that he is grateful to him. Despite his transformation, he retains his own will. Apologizing to Terrio, Garo claims that it is now time to conduct evil. And that does it. That is Garo's journey from where the anime ended to where we are now in the manga. And I think you guys can agree with me that it is insane how strong he's become over the course of this Monster Association arc, right? So if you guys enjoyed this video, please, please, please like and subscribe and hit that notification bell. It took me forever to make this one, so any support would be greatly, greatly appreciated. So if you guys like longer form videos like this, as opposed to my, you know, shorter videos that I usually make, let me know in the comments below and I'll keep it coming. But until next time, I'll see you guys later.